estudos avançados transdisciplinares e a Faculdade de Medicina, Escola de Enfermagem e Faculdade de Letras da UFMG. Para iniciarmos os trabalhos desta manhã, convidamos a professora Elza Machado Melo, coordenadora do Núcleo de Estudos sobre Violência, Saúde e Violência da Faculdade de Medicina.
Bom dia. Quero dar boas-vindas a todos e quero pedir ao professor Francisco Pena, diretor da Faculdade de Medicina, que abra essa sessão para nós.
Eu gostaria de dar as boas-vindas a todos e dizer que essas promoções são muito bem-vindas à nossa instituição. O IEAC, o Instituto de Estudos Avançados Transdisciplinares da Universidade, ele promove eventos de natureza científica, trazendo figuras importantes para a comunidade científica internacional para fazer palestras e discussões em diferentes áreas do conhecimento. E hoje nós temos o prazer de receber na nossa faculdade o professor Marcos Carapós, da Universidade do Texas, que fará a sua palestra a respeito da racionalidade da violência e terá um debate com participação de outras instituições. Essa, então, na nossa faculdade, é uma solução conjunta do IAC com o Departamento de Medicina Preventiva, através do Núcleo de Estudos sobre Saúde e Violência, e que é coordenado pela professora Elza. Eu vou passar, então, a direção do trabalho para a professora Elza. Muito obrigado.
Muito obrigada, professor Francisco. Nós vamos fazer um evento sem muitas formalidades, porque o que a gente precisa mesmo é produzir conhecimento, possibilidades de intervenções sobre esse grave problema que nos preocupa tanto, que é a violência. Sobretudo, interessa para nós trabalharmos a relação saúde e violência, uma vez que ela tem uma relação direta com toda a nossa área. Desde a questão de que as vítimas chegam e desenvolvam um sistema de saúde, seja porque é um dos problemas prevalentes que chegam aos serviços, comprometem a qualidade, comprometem a utilização dos recursos, seja porque os próprios profissionais, nesse momento, já são vítimas da própria violência. Então, a relação saúde-violência é direta e, principalmente, quando a gente trabalha a saúde numa concepção ampla que leva em consideração a qualidade de vida de todas as pessoas. Não há nada que agride mais a qualidade de vida, a dignidade e o próprio direito de sobreviver do que a violência, tanto na sua forma definitiva do homicídio, como a violência nas suas múltiplas fases, sejam as agressões físicas, ideológicas, preconceito, exclusão, desigualdade, falta de condições de vida. Então, esse é um assunto que necessariamente a universidade tem que abordar como uma das suas temáticas principais e se debruçar sobre ele para encontrar formas adequadas de abordagem. O nosso evento vai ser bem mais rápido, então nós vamos começar com a fala do professor Mark Stafford, que é da cátedra da Fundação Ford, que é sociólogo da Universidade do Texas. Imediatamente após, nós teremos debatedores das instituições brasileiras e mineiras e de Belo Horizonte que têm abordado essa questão. Ministério da Saúde com a doutora Marta, Secretaria Municipal com a doutora Rosemir, a Ludmila do programa Vidas Vivo, a professora Beatriz da PUC Minas, quem mais eu estou esquecendo, gente? O seu Ivo da comunidade, Tadir, o Jorge, o Sebastião, quem mais, gente? A Corine, que foi uma das organizadoras desse evento, pelo CRISP e pelo IAT.
I think back to the fact that the meaning of rationality is very controversial, at least in academic circles in the U.S. And so I had a few meanings that I'd like to share with you, and hopefully tell you the meaning that I adopted in my own thinking. To some, the word rationality means the extent to which people act understandably, at least in ways that are understandable to the observers. But to other people, it means that people make good choices. To some, rational means conscious and deliberate calculations about the consequences of an action, while others deny that mental calculations of any kind are necessarily involved. To some, rational choices are willful rather than determined, while still others believe the measure of rationality is neutral with respect to the free will or determinism debate. But there are actually old meanings associated with the word rationality, and there are new meanings associated with the word rationality. The old meaning is that people engage in conscious and deliberate cost-benefit analysis, such that they maximize the values and minimize the costs associated with their actions. The new meaning is different. It's that people intuit the values and costs of an action, but because they're imperfect processors of information, they pursue what they perceive as most satisfying. The assumption of maximizing in the old version is rejected, and it's replaced by such alternative assumptions as satisficing and bounded or situational rationality. What I describe here is a situation where, over time, we've come to assume that the rationality means something different than we assumed it was the case several hundred years ago when philosophers first began to talk about the costs and benefits of behaviors. Today we recognize that people often have limited information about what's good and what's bad for them. And we believe in this area of research that the people try to make use of the best information they have, despite the fact that their information may be incomplete. And so you'll see this kind of thinking really distributed or included in the kinds of work that I'll describe to you today. I should probably give you a little bit of brief history about myself, other than the fact that I live in the state of Texas. I was actually born in the state of Texas, many Americans makes the situation even worse by saying that we sometimes are very distinct as Americans. Nonetheless, my dissertation research, my PhD research, was on the deterrent effects of legal punishment, which is very much a rationality kind of issue. Specifically, I looked at the extent to which group behavior affected the deterrence process. Even more specifically, I looked at the extent to which juveniles or young people violate the law in groups, and whether these group violators, as I call them, were more or less deterrable than those young persons who violated the law alone. So my initial research was focused on an issue having to do with rationality and crime, or lawbreaking, albeit among young persons. I continued this line of research for a fairly long period of time, although I shifted away from studying juveniles in the community to conducting laboratory research on the deterrent effects of punishment. And these were studies designed to test some very basic ideas about human choice behavior. We manipulated the costs and rewards that people experience and observe the kinds of responses they make to these kinds of conditions. For example, one of the things we did in our research was to look at the effects of alcohol on the decision or choice-making process. We believe that, as many people had, that alcohol would affect the way that people made decisions, perhaps make them less rational as decision makers. So this is something that we studied in our research. We also looked at the extent, again, of group participation on choice behavior in this laboratory situation. And if you like, I can elaborate on this later. But we found something very surprising to us, but something that we can make sense of later. We actually found that the people who were asked to make choices in groups were more rational than those who were asked to make decisions alone. They were more rational in the sense that when it was to their advantage, divided in rule, which is to say the rewards divided in rule were greater than the costs divided in rule, then those who were asked to make that kind of decision with others were more likely to adopt that more rational choice, if you will. Those who were asked to make a decision alone would often choose the less rational, less rewarding, really, at least relatively rewarding choice. So that's kind of an odd finding, but something that I think is very much related to the topic of violence generally. One of the things that I'll share with you at the moment is that we know that most crimes are committed by persons acting in groups. Most offenders do not violate the law alone, although this varies by age, with young offenders more likely to violate the law in groups than older offenders. But murderers, those persons who commit homicide, almost overwhelmingly commit their crime alone. There are exceptions, of course, with gang violence and so forth, but the more common or mundane kinds of homicides that occur involving interpersonal disputes, something I'll comment about more at home. They tend to involve people acting alone. So from the perspective of this laboratory research that I described, it may very well be that people acting in groups, facing situations about choices to commit homicide or not, will choose the more rational line of action. They'll choose not to commit homicide, because most of the time it is more punishing than rewarding. Lone offenders, though, are those who are in a situation to choose by themselves whether to commit homicide or not. Often will choose to choose the less rational approach. They'll choose to commit a crime that in the end is often more punishing than rewarding. So it's a very academic kind of issue, but it has applications nonetheless for what we actually experience or observe in what we call the real world. Much more recently, skipping ahead from my early research as a sociologist and some of the research that I've been conducting over the past few years, much of that research is focused on two kinds of violence. One of them is homicide, but the second is sex offending, and I'll describe both of those lines of research to you in some detail. A colleague and I began our research on homicide with a simple observation. And the observation is that, as I mentioned a moment ago, the vast majority of homicides usually begin with an interpersonal dispute. Again, there are exceptions, such as gang violence and so forth, but in most instances, homicides involve interpersonal disputes. And interpersonal disputes usually begin with a grievance. At some point, someone does something to someone else that makes them angry or upset, anxious, makes them feel bad in a general sense. And the person who suffers the grievance then has a choice. One of those choices is to suffer in silence, which is probably the most common response to suffering and grievance. And in many ways, that's probably very good. We can't really imagine a world in which everyone responds to a grievance without suffering in silence. But some people who suffer a grievance will complain to the grievance source. So let's assume that I done something to you to offend you. You may suffer in silence. But then you also may complain to me. You may point out to me that I have offended you. And you may even ask for an apology. At this point, I, as the source of your grievance, have several options available. One of them is I can apologize. I can try to placate you, somehow undo the grievance that I've made you suffer. I also may simply tell you that I'm not going to apologize. I reject your complaint. And at that point, we believe a full-blown dispute is present. Once a dispute occurs, Then, the two disputants now have several options available to them. Both of them, in a sense, can suffer the dispute and silence, as the original agreement did. But most importantly, as far as violence is concerned, I believe, the disputants can turn to third parties for peaceful resolution of the dispute. And as far as violence is concerned, as you will begin to understand more fully as I continue, as far as violence is concerned, the solicitation of third parties seems to be critical. One of the things that we often observe in the study of violence is that males are much more likely to commit violence than females. This seems to be universal. It's true in the United States, it's true in Brazil, it's true really everywhere, although there's variation with regard to the ratio of males to female violence. But really everywhere, males commit more violence. Well, in some of our research, we've learned that it's not that males suffer more grievances. In fact, as it turns out, females, in the United States at least, I think Brazil is probably no different, females suffer more grievances than do males. The primary difference between males and females, this is relevant to violence, is that females are much more likely than males to solicit the intervention of a third party for peaceful resolution of the dispute. We can see this among elementary school children, among young school children. When two girls become involved in an argument, a dispute, one of the things that usually happens is that at least one of them, and often both, will run to a teacher. And as we say in the United States, one or both will tackle to the teacher. They will tell on the other. Mary did this to me, or Jane did that to me. And so the teacher is solicited to intervene to resolve the dispute. Boys, young boys, are much less likely than young girls to do this. In fact, when we observe children in school, we see that disputes among boys are much more likely to result in violence. They go directly to violence. Well, this is an example, really, of the importance of soliciting third parties for peaceful intervention. So, let's assume that's two disputes. Both go to a third party for peaceful resolution of that dispute. They both solicit the intervention of someone else. They may be successful, or at least one of them may be successful. And so a third party, the person to whom they turn for help, may agree to intervene, may agree to resolve the dispute. In this sense, the disputant has experienced a success trying to control the behavior of the third party. It could be, though, that the disputants failed in their attempts to solicit the intervention of the third party. The third party may not want to get involved, for example. At this point, the disputants who have tried to solicit the third party to intervene will have also failed. The third party may agree to intervene to try to come to some peaceful resolution, and may actually attempt to do so. But that third party may fail in the attempt to intervene and somehow resolve the dispute peacefully. At this point, or in this kind of situation, the third party will have failed in the attempt to somehow resolve the dispute. Well, I keep mentioning this notion of controlled failure, because as we see it, the greater the number of controlled failures that occur in this process, the greater the likelihood of violence. If we back up to the beginning, I did something to you that offends you, that makes you angry or upset, and you complain to me. In a very important way, you're attempting to control my behavior. You're attempting to get an apology from me, or at least some different kind of behavior from me. To the extent that I agree, that I comply with your request, your attempt to control my behavior, then most often that reduces, if not eliminates, the cause of violence. As we move through this dispute process, then, the chances and probability of violence begin to increase considerably over time, to the point where people can become involved in such serious disputes that violence is often seen by them, at least, as the only remaining alternative. Sociologists have written about violence as a means of controlling the behavior of other people. And as I see it, violence is often used as an attempt to control the behavior of others. We can see this in domestic violence situations, for example. One of the people in a marriage may be upset with the way the other person is acting, or even fear that the other person will somehow cause the person to suffer a grievance. The grievance may not have yet occurred, but maybe anticipation that a grievance might occur. In these kinds of situations, spouse and partners, marital partners most often, will often engage in violence as an attempt to control the behavior of the other. I have no trouble with this idea. The only thing I would add to the idea is that violence is usually unsuccessful as a means of controlling behavior. It usually fails. And as is often said, violence tends to beget violence. Violence tends to lead to more violence. And so throughout the dispute process, the ideal situation would be one where people are searching for nonviolent means of control, peaceful ways of resolving disputes. And there are many kinds of ways that are available to people to shorten the violence. For some, though, violence may be perceived really as the only alternative. I know in Brazil, all of you have been hearing, I've certainly been asked about this many times since I arrived in Brazil. As you know, there's a great deal of violence associated with drug trafficking, as evidenced by the recent violence in Sao Paulo. Drug trafficking is a very good example of the kind of thing that I'm describing. Drug traffickers often become involved in disputes. They suffer grievances at the hands of other drug traffickers. There may be complaints, there may not be, and they may skip directly to violence, having some experience in this process. But let's assume for a moment that they actually complain to another drug trafficker who might be somehow impinging upon the other's drug territory. Well, it would be unlikely that the drug trafficker who got to the complaint will back down and say, I'm sorry, I somehow intruded on your drug trafficking area. I'll see. It's much more likely in such a situation that the two drug traffickers will become involved in a dispute. And at this point, they really have very few options available to them. They cannot turn to third parties for a peaceful resolution of a dispute. Imagine a drug trafficker, two drug traffickers, going to legal officials and saying, you know, this drug trafficker over here is somehow impinging upon my territory. I wish that this person would stop, and I want you to help me in somehow convincing this person to quit invading my territory. Obviously, that's a very silly kind of situation to consider. It's not going to happen. But drug traffickers, there are few options available for settling disputes other than violence. The problem is, as I mentioned a moment ago, violence tends to beget violence. And so the violence that begins in those drug traffickers tends to lead to more violence rather than less. It doesn't tend to solve disputes. So we see this ever-increasing rate of violence among drug traffickers in Brazil and in the United States. This is very much relevant to helping us understand some of the problems with violence in the United States. Public officials or scholars anticipated the very large increase in youth violence, especially among African American males in particular. particular. Well, many began to search around for an explanation of this. And one of the explanations that was posed is very much consistent with what I described with regard to the idea of grievances and disputes, the escalation of disputes and violence, and violence begetting violence, and so forth. What began to occur in the United States, especially in slum areas of cities, populated mainly by African Americans, was the introduction of crack. Crack was a new drug in the United States in the mid-1980s. And as many of you know, crack is a drug that's usually sold in small quantities. That's one of the real attractions of buying crack. We sold it in small quantities for relatively small amounts of money. Well, because of the fact that it was sold in small quantities, buyers and sellers had frequent contact with one another. And more so than other kinds of drugs, where buyers would often buy larger amounts of the drug than they would buy cocaine. Well, these very frequent interactions between buyers and sellers increased the likelihood of disputes, grievances initially, but ultimately disputes. And as is the case with drug trafficking, there were few peaceful ways to resolve these disputes. In the crack cocaine market in the United States in the 1980s, there were few rules to govern these kinds of interactions, not formal rules, but informal rules that had developed in other drug industries, illegal drug industries in the United States. What began to develop among buyers and sellers of crack cocaine in the United States was an increased fear of violence. And so both buyers and sellers began to arm themselves with lethal weapons. As the disputes began to increase, as the amount of crack cocaine began to increase as well, we did begin to witness more and more violence. It seems that the crack cocaine market, as I described it, contributed mainly to this explosion and youth homicides during the period 1985 to 1995. Well, almost as quickly as the youth homicide rate increased, it began to decrease in the mid-1990s, roughly 10 years ago. What seemed to happen was that the crack cocaine market began to regulate itself. As an industry, so to speak, that had more experience with the marketplace, they began to develop informal rules that would, in many ways, begin to resolve disputes in nonviolent ways. As the buyers and sellers became more confident in the fact that they wouldn't be subjected to violence, they armed themselves less frequently. And so there was a decrease in the violence associated with the sellers' crack cocaine in the United States. It's an example, I think, for a good illustration of the kind of process I'm describing. For many persons involved in illicit activities, such as drug trafficking, drug selling, drug buying, in many instances, violence is seen by them, at least, as one of the very few alternatives to resolve disputes. Now, from our perspective, that may not be terribly rational, because most of us would see violence as an irrational way of settling disputes among ourselves. We see the cost, far exceeding the benefits of engaging in the violent behavior. But remember I said that the new version of rationality takes into account that people often have limited information about the situations in which they're asked to make choices. Often drug traffickers, drug sellers, drug buyers, participants in spousal violence, and so on, cannot see the complete picture. They have limited or incomplete information, and they are asked then to make choices with the incomplete information that is somehow offered to them. And so we can make sense of the kinds of violence in which you engage from this kind of rational force or rationality perspective. I'll be more than glad to talk to you about this line of research if you choose during the question and answer period. I mentioned now that another area of research in which I've engaged more recently is research on sex ethnicity. And for me, this is a very new and sort of unique area of study. And I'd like to sort of tell you the story, the history of my involvement in that research. About two summers ago, I was asked to participate in a panel discussion on sex ethnicity. I really did this as a favor to a graduate student who was asked to put on this panel discussion for a very large group of law enforcement and treatment personnel who were focused on the problems of sex offending in the United States. Well, at this particular point in time, I had really done no research on sex offending, and I've really done very little reading on sex offending. Sociologists, for many reasons, have chosen to look at other kinds of criminal behavior, crimes other than sex offending. So sociologists really have not done much research on that kind of criminal behavior. In any case, I being a person who has never wanted to speak to a crowd, agreed to participate. I was able to formulate some ideas that I decided to share from some very general theories of the crime population. One of the most widely accepted theories at the moment is self-control theory. And self-control theory is relatively simple. It's the crime attributable mainly to two things: low self-control and the opportunity to commit crime. So people with low self-control, when given the opportunity to commit a crime, will do so. Well, as part of self-control theory, there's the claim that most offenders, really all offenders, are generalists rather than specialists. This is to say they don't specialize in only some types of crimes. Well, I took this to imply that sex offenders, if they're like all other kinds of offenders, do not specialize. They do not limit themselves to sex offenses. So I shared this as part of my participation in the panel discussion. Well, generally, the panel discussion went fine from my perspective, but there were many people in the audience, especially one young woman, who was challenging me very seriously about what I had said about the generality of offending, that sex offenders, if they're like other offenders, probably committed other crimes as well. She, like many people in the audience, did not want to accept that claim, mainly because she saw sex offenders as fundamentally different from other kinds of offenders. In the United States, we're experiencing what sociologists would call a moral panic with regard to sex offenders, mainly because of some very sensationalistic killings of children by sex offenders during the past 10 years or so. The American public has become gravely concerned, and a great deal of public attention has been placed on those persons who commit sex offenses. And as part of this moral panic, sex offenders have come to be demonized. They come to be viewed as devils, rather monsters, people who are fundamentally different from other kinds of persons. Well, as a sociologist who studied crime, I didn't have that bias. I saw sex offenders as offenders like many others, and I believe that if they like other criminals, they also commit a variety of offenses. Well, this is something that was inconsistent with many in the audience and their belief that sex offenders were somehow different. They weren't like robbers, burglars, and shoplifters. They were fundamentally different kinds of person. So I left with that sort of challenge to what I had to say. A few weeks passed, and I received a telephone call from one of the other participants in the panel. This is a psychologist who was involved in treatment of sex offenders. He asked me if I was interested in sitting in on a few of his treatment. I was at first reluctant, and for a variety of reasons, but one of the most important to me was I was concerned about my legal liability. As a researcher, I'm concerned that sometimes I learn information about criminal behavior that I have to release or turn over to legal officials. In the case of sex offending, this is especially problematic because It is such a source of public attention in the United States. The psychologist hastened to add that this is not a crime. But in fact, sex offenders in treatment have no legal rights to confidentiality. They actually signed a document before they began treatment, agreeing that whatever they said will be used against them and will be reported to legal officials by the psychologists themselves. So my presence there added no additional ethical problem, or in no way added to the kinds of dangers that they generally experience from treatment. So I agree. I agreed to observe a couple of these treatment sessions. The psychologist encouraged me to attend at least four of these treatment sessions, saying that it didn't really take that long for me to understand what this was all about. He encouraged me to take notes and to feel very comfortable. So I went. In the very beginning, I was overwhelmed by what I observed, by what I heard. I'd never done this kind of research before. My research prior to this point was quantitative. I had dealt with secondary data or survey data. I'd never collected what we call qualitative data, interview or observational data of this sort. I was somewhat overwhelmed by the amount of material that was being made available. I first began to try to apply the things that I was hearing to existing theories of crime, such as self-control theory. I quickly realized I wasn't learning anything new. I was just applying these ideas to old theories, old ideas about the causes of crime, and so forth. So I consciously, deliberately, rationally perhaps, decided to discard my theoretical biases and try to listen to learn new things. Suppose I did. I did begin to learn a great deal about sex offending and about criminal behaviors that I had never really learned before. One of the things was that much of the behavior of sex offending does, at least seem to me, to be rational. Not perhaps in the ways that many people would consider the word rationality to mean. Certainly, these sex offenders in treatment have not made good choices from the perspective of outsiders. They often make very bad choices. But given the limited information available to them, they often make choices that seem the best to them, at least in the moment. One of the great controversies in the sociological study of crime is the extent to which criminal offenders are impulsive. Most researchers believe that the criminal offenders generally are impulsive. They act on the spur of the moment. They act spontaneously, without thinking. One of the first things I learned about sex offenders is that many of them plan their offenses, sometimes over a very long period of time. There was one gentleman in the group that I observed who planned his offense for a 2-year period. Ultimately, he molested his teenage stepdaughter. But he had planned this over a 2-year period. As I began to look more closely into the sex offender literature, it's not part of sociology, was really developed by psychologists and treatment specialists who were studying health. I began to learn that there's actually a term for this. It's called grooming. And sex offenders often groom their victims. By grooming, we mean that they create situations in which their victimization, their violation of the victim, becomes easier for them. And I begin to hear many examples of this kind of grooming behavior. So rather than acting spontaneously, spur of the moment, many sex offenders gave considerable thought to their offending prior to the act. Well, it is part of sort of conventional theorizing about the causes of crime. Many people also believe that crimes generally have little value to offenders. This is one of the reasons why they tend to act spontaneously. They committed offenses that were of little value to them, and they commit this offense, then later move on to another offense. This then help us understand why the vast majority of offenders would commit reverse acts of criminal offenses. Well, sex offenders seem to value their crimes a great deal. It's not that they value the sex offending little, they value sex offending a lot. And I began to reason that perhaps this is one of the reasons why they're so willing to invest large amounts of time in the planning of these offenses. For them, the crime is something that would bring them considerable pleasure or reward. I also learned that along the way, there was short-term rewards. Because the vast majority of sex offenders in the planning stages will fantasize about their behaviors prior to committing them. In fact, one of the things they seem to find very rewarding about sex offending is the fantasizing, the pre-planning. For them, the fantasizing is a way of receiving pleasure from the offense, prior to ever committing the offense. It's the rehearsal of the behavior that they find so rewarding. For some, the fantasizing, the rehearsals, are more rewarding, in fact, than the behavior itself. As many of the sex offenders would say, they would find that when they finally committed sex offense, it wasn't as good as what they had hoped it to be. Their fantasizing had led them to believe it would be much better. But throughout the planning process, we would hear about these kinds of fantasies that would provide short-term rewards, if nothing else, and would enable them to engage in long-term planning. Repeatedly, I heard evidence from these offenders of behaviors that I took to identify as extremely rational. Again, at least from their perspective, given the limited amount of opportunity that they had. I remember one morning, and these were very early morning sessions, which is one of the difficulties I had in conducting research. It actually began at 7 a.m. and lasted for an hour and a half, so this was prior to the time I'm usually awake. But one of these early mornings, I actually heard something that made me very awake pretty quickly. One of the offenders was describing the decision-making that he went through in deciding who to molest on a public bus. This was a gentleman who engaged in a wide variety of sex offenses. He was very versatile in his sex offenses. One of the things he would do would be to touch women on buses, of course, without their permission. But he had a very strict set of rules about who he could touch. For example, if the bus was filled and there was one empty seat as he was entering the bus, and the only empty seat was next to a woman, he would not consider her a potential victim to molest. Why? Because she had not yet given him permission. On the other hand, if a young woman, and his choice was usually young women, decided to sit beside him on a bus, to sit in the seat next to him, he took that as permission, as evidence that she was willing to go along with this. But from the perspective of most of us, that's crazy. That's irrational. We would think that that's just incredulous. But from his perspective, it was a hard and fast rule. He would never molest a woman who did not sit beside him first. He had a set of rational rules from his perspective. Now, one of the things that's been mentioned about criminals generally, not just sex offenders, is that they often tend to engage in thinking errors, as we call them. And this is a good example of a thinking error. From the perspective of most of us, rules about folks in the left are kinds of thinking errors. From the perspective of many sex offenders, these are rational, legitimate kinds of rules to have, deciding who to victimize and who not. And so part of the treatment process, offenders are re-educated, if you will, about the kinds of thinking errors that have led them to engage in sex offending. There was much evidence of this kind of a thinking error, misperceptions, miscalculations of assessment as time went on. There was another gentleman in this group who I like to describe as a professional exhibitionist. I'm not sure how the word exhibitionist will translate. But these are people who will expose themselves to other places. He was a professional in the sense that he engaged in exhibitionism each day of the year for 10 years. Again, his process was very radical from his perspective. He had intentionally selected a public park in Austin, Texas, and intentionally selected a particular bathroom in the public park. And the location of the bathroom was important because it was located very close to a women's bathroom. And it was also located close to an area where children would often play. So he actually did his research and came to conclude that there would be many young girls walking by the public bathroom, presenting him with the opportunity to expose himself. He was very careful, very deliberate in planning his affinity. Over time, he became quite expert at it. But what he would do would be to undress himself very close to the door, the entrance to his bathroom. So as young girls would walk by, he would often make noises to get their attention, and they would see him. They could see him fully exposed in front of them. What was important, though, was that he had a way of explaining his behavior in this context. If anyone ever complained, he could simply say that he was fixing himself, accidentally had exposed himself to the victims. He was very successful for 10 years. Ultimately, he was reported to the police by two young boys who were in the bathroom with him, who saw his behavior and reported it. The offender was upset, and he complained openly about the fact that these young boys had reported him to the police because, from his perspective, he was not exposing himself to the young boys. This was unfair then for them to report him to the police. He exposed himself only to girls, so these young boys should not complain. From my perspective, irrational. It makes no sense to us whatsoever, but from his perspective, it made perfect thinking errors, as they're often called. I can go on and on with these kinds of examples of thinking errors. Rationality, in the new sense of the term, decision-making, choice of behavior based on very limited and often incorrect kinds of information, but nonetheless, decisions that make sense to them, and in order to understand the behaviors, you almost have to crawl within their heads. You have to begin to think as they do, to understand the rationality of their thinking. One of the most interesting things to me in listening to these offenders in treatment was that they themselves could identify the thinking errors, we might call it the irrationality, of the other offenders in the group. The group was made up of a variety of different kinds of sex offenders. There were individuals who committed forcible rape. There were men, they were all men, by the way. There were men who had molested family members. There were men who had molested strangers. There were men who had solicited children for sexual purposes online. There was a variety of sexual offenders. And as one of them would be describing what he had done, or what he liked to do, what he fantasized about, or whatever, the other offenders would often be able, even more quickly than I, to identify the thinking errors, to identify the sort of misperceptions, miscalculations that were involved. And the reason was that many of them who engaged in a particular kind of behavior would find it incredulous that anyone could engage in some other kinds of deception. Now, when I say that deception offenders tend to generalize, they do tend to generalize even with regard to sex offenders. Rarely will you find a sex offender who commits only one kind of sex offense. So, for example, those who victimize children most often have also victimized adults. Those who victimize family members most often also will have victimized strangers. So they're generalists in this sense. But this isn't to say that sex offenders commit all sex offenses. They do have clear identifiable preferences. And they also have clear identifiable kinds of behaviors in which they will not engage. And so these offenders will often listen to the accounts of the others, especially about behaviors they personally will not commit. And they can instantly identify the thinking error, the misperception, the miscalculations. And so in this kind of treatment setting, they were able to help one another see the reasons for their offense. This is, of course, very useful for treatment purposes. In the long run, really, when you begin to look forward to spending more of your sex offenders, it's time to leave the room. I began to put together my notes in some systematic manner. But to me, it was very rewarding and valuable to have this sort of first-hand experience, as was laid out to me by the defendants themselves. Beginning with a situation where even I thought that their behavior was somehow irrational, perhaps even different from the behavior of other criminals, I ultimately began to see there's a great deal of rationality, perverse rationality, probably, but still a great deal of rationale about that the offenders would use to make the decisions that they did to commit particular offenses. They rarely would act spontaneously. They rarely would act spur of the moment. Even if it seemed as if they were doing so, because of the fact that they'd often fantasized or rehearsed these behaviors long before they first committed them, their behavior was not really spontaneous. It was not really spur of the moment. It was something they had educated themselves for. When the opportunity presented itself, they seized it. And so it might seem to be spontaneous, spur of the moment, but it really was not. So repeatedly, I heard evidence of this kind of rationality. Well, hopefully you can see that in both areas of research, the research on homicide, the research on sex offenses, That while Finnegan may not be able to understand in the beginning the rationality that's involved, for many offenders, there is rationality in this new source. Limited, perhaps incorrect information they have about the opportunities available to them, or the likes and dislikes of other people that they might consider victimizing, that they do in the end try to make decisions as best they can. And in the process, try to maximize the values of the behavior and minimize the costs. So I think viewing criminal behavior in this way can be very beneficial. Obviously, if we're to in any way address the problems of violence, homicide, sex offending, whatever the form of violence that we address, we must be able to identify the true causes, the root causes of those behaviors. Unless we do so, our efforts that prevention or rehabilitation will ultimately fail. So this kind of research, I believe, is extremely important. And it's important to then translate that research into the arena of policy and prevention and rehabilitation. One of the things I'm very much interested in learning from you is as I close what I would like to say to you formally today, is that I'd very much like to learn from you how the medical community is linked to the study and development of public policy regarding violence. In the U.S., there is not a close connection between health and violence. And I'm very much interested in this because I've told several people already this morning. I attended a meeting a few years ago in London. London School of Economics was sponsoring a group. There were a few was from the U.S., and there were people from Colombia, and Salvador, and Mexico, and I believe there were even from Brazil, that picture. But with the exception of those was from the U.S., the others were all involved in public health. And public health had made this very strong commitment to violence. And this is something that, as I say, it has not occurred in the United States except on a very limited scale. So I'm very much interested in learning from you as we continue our discussion today, how this works in Brazil, that the kinds of links between researchers such as myself and the medical community such as yourselves. Because I believe there is a great deal of value to doing so. I do know, and I'll leave you with this final example, that in the U.S., the medical community fairly recently became very instrumental in identifying the problem of child physical abuse. And this really has only occurred over the past 40 years. But as part of the case in many societies, child physical abuse had remained very hidden. We believe that the family was the privacy of the family was very important to maintain, so whatever violence occurred in families had to remain the family. Well, as it turns out, pediatricians, those who treated children, had known that there had been a great deal of child physical abuse for many, many years. But in the U.S., there were problems with confidentiality, problems of reporting this to legal officials. It was unclear whether or not their pledge of confidentiality was to the child victim or to the parents. Radiologists, however, did not have such an ethical dilemma. And as they began to read x-rays of the victims of child physical abuse, they could clearly begin to estimate the extent of the problem. The radiologists were the ones who went to public officials initially to identify the extent of the problem. And from that point on, policymakers, public officials, and others began to respond quite actively to the problem. Where the situation today in the United States regarding child physical abuse is much different than it was 40 years ago. We take that kind of violence very seriously today and do everything we can to try to address it. Teachers in the United States now are required by law to report anything that might be suspicious of child physical abuse. So this gives you some idea of the change that's occurred over a very short period of time, and entirely because of the responses in the medical community. So I'm very much aware of this kind of history and how these kinds of links are very important. But I'm much interested as well in discovering how Brazilians, how you and the medical community here have extended this kind of cooperation. I thank you very much. Again, I'm very honored to be here. I'm very honored by the large number of you who are here who are very patient to listen to me in English. I thank you very much.
Questões que eu acho assim, que eu concordo, tem outras questões que eu discordo, E acho que é muito interessante o que você está trazendo da questão da racionalidade, da violência, até para a gente entender alguns fenômenos que ocorrem do ponto de vista de relações entre indivíduos. Você traz muita questão aí que isso você pode estar generalizando do ponto de vista de tanto de crimes, homicídios, crimes interpessoais, como da questão da agressão física. Coloca algumas exceções do ponto de vista de gangues, né, crimes organizados, crimes como os que a gente tem visto aqui no Brasil, em São Paulo, de toda a questão dos grupos. Agora, o que me preocupa nessa questão que está sendo colocada é do ponto de vista que, para a gente trabalhar, e dessa forma a gente tem trabalhado dentro do ponto de vista da saúde, você colocou aí o interesse da curiosidade de como que a saúde está trabalhando, os pesquisadores, né, das universidades, sempre colocando. Então, para nós, a violência, ela tem questões, suas origens, suas causas são muito complexas, são múltiplas e tem toda uma correlação social com a determinação política, com a determinação econômica. Então, o que eu pego? Essa questão da racionalidade, pelo que eu entendi também, né, pelo que eu pude captar, né, dentro da questão toda da racionalidade, onde eu tenho aí disputas entre pessoas, onde eu tenho jogo de interesse, e você traz a questão da visão limitada, né, entre escolhas, entre tomadas de decisões por parte de pessoas, onde eu posso ter um conflito entre duas pessoas e essas duas pessoas solicitarem intermediação de uma terceira pessoa, você citou o exemplo aí da violência doméstica, ou uma violência interpessoal na rua, que pode ter sucesso dependendo do poder ou não, da conciliação, da resolução daquele conflito. Então, eu tendo a entender que a maneira como está sendo colocada a explicação da violência, ela reduz ao ponto de vista das relações interpessoais, intersubjetivas e ligada muito à questão da psicanálise, da tolerância, do autocontrole, até quando você coloca a questão da prevenção, da reabilitação, da reeducação, fica muito centrada na questão do indivíduo. E aí, pela questão do indivíduo, eu também estou focando na questão da culpabilização da pessoa pelo crime. Quando a gente trabalha a questão da violência e temos trabalhado isso na saúde, a gente parte do pressuposto dos determinantes e dos condicionantes. Quando eu estou trazendo a questão dos determinantes, eu passo por uma discussão que tem a ver com a exclusão social. Porque se eu pego ali o exemplo que você trouxe do traficante, como consumidor de drogas, e eles têm ali um conflito, tem um jogo de interesse, de repente são dois traficantes envolvidos, tem uma briga por território, e aí a questão toda que vai dar, que não dá para chamar uma polícia ou uma terceira pessoa para resolver aquele conflito que está ali posto. Só que existe.
Diferente em alguns países, às vezes ela traz a violência.
eu já vou concluir. Então, lá no Ministério da Saúde, a gente tem trabalhado dentro dessa perspectiva, a gente está implantando no país núcleos de prevenção de violência e promoção da saúde, que são núcleos intersetoriais, onde eu tenho uma articulação entre segurança pública, entre saúde, entre educação, entre as organizações não governamentais, a sociedade civil organizada como um todo, ou seja, todos os cidadãos participando dentro de uma construção de uma política pública que gere realmente inclusão social com a cidadania. Tá? Então, os meus questionamentos iniciais, que eu queria estar colocando aí, tá? Da determinação e da parte dos fenômenos que envolvem a questão da violência. Obrigada. O programa Fica Vivo, na verdade, o nome inicial é o Programa de Controle de Homicídios. Nós trabalhamos hoje, através da Secretaria de Estado de Defesa Social, em regiões de alto índice de criminalidade. Então, logo de início, foi feita uma pesquisa pela Universidade Federal, através do CRIS, que apontavam as maiores áreas de homicídios na região de Belo Horizonte e depois Minas Gerais. A partir dessa pesquisa, nós então pudemos implantar o programa hoje já em 17 municípios e regiões de Belo Horizonte. Aqui nós estamos especificamente em Belo Horizonte, na pesquisa Fábio Lopes, em Morro das Pedras, na Cabana, no Ribeiro, no Conjunto Felicidade, no Taquari, e estamos em Serra, Santa Lúcia e Barreiro. Bem, apenas para mostrar, o programa que eu vivo, ele trabalha exatamente em regiões de homicídio, mas não apenas com esse panorama, mas também uma situação onde nós temos vários jovens envolvidos nesses homicídios. Então, o programa trabalha com jovens de 14 a 24 anos. É uma política para jovens de 14 a 24 anos, nesses locais que geralmente são favelas, onde então nós vamos fazer uma intervenção a partir do programa em parceria com outro programa da Universidade Federal, que também está hoje dentro da Secretaria de Saúde Social, que é o programa de mediação aos conflitos. O que eu vivo, ele vai atender a esse público, intervenções na área, a partir de oficinas culturais, onde nós atendendo no primeiro momento os jovens com as oficinas, mas contando com toda a participação da saúde, da educação, das comunidades envolvidas. Então, nós temos, no primeiro momento, o diagnóstico que vai nos apontar a área. Depois do diagnóstico, é feito todo o trabalho com a comunidade para levantar os maiores problemas de violência nessas comunidades. A partir deste levantamento, deste diagnóstico feito junto com a comunidade, nós vamos, então, fazer algumas intervenções a partir de grupos de trabalho. Então, nós temos um grupo de trabalho que trabalha educação, grupos que vão trabalhar saúde,
grupos que vão trabalhar a inclusão produtiva, a comunicação, e atualmente a gente está trabalhando um pouco também com a questão da urbanização a partir de uma parceria com a PUC. Isso é, nós vamos participar das discussões que nessas comunidades já existem relacionadas às essas temáticas. A maior via de acesso que nós temos aos jovens, porque os jovens do programa Fica Vivo, né, os jovens desses locais, né, não só do programa, eles, na maioria das vezes, estão fora das escolas, já não estão engajados em nenhuma política pública. Então, nós usamos como uma ferramenta para nos aproximar dele as oficinas. Então, nós temos oficinas de cultura, de lazer e de esporte. Eu trouxe até umas fotos, se tiver como passar. E as oficinas, então, a gente costuma trabalhar como uma porta de entrada para que os jovens possam ter acesso ao programa e, a partir daí, a gente poder fazer um acompanhamento mais sistemático. Então, nós temos uma intervenção. Uma intervenção que é mais geral, através das oficinas. Uma intervenção que é mais geral, que é para todos os jovens da comunidade que quiserem entrar no programa, que são as oficinas. Depois, algumas intervenções mais específicas. Alguns jovens, então, a partir das oficinas, vão poder participar de cursos de capacitação, vão poder estar sendo encaminhados para o mercado de trabalho, formal ou informal. Nós tivemos algumas intervenções, por exemplo, na região, em algumas regiões de Belo Horizonte e também em Santa Luzia, que é conseguir montar escola para jovens adultos, desses jovens que estão fora da escola, então vão ter perspectivas de incluí-los. Né? Agora, o Fica Vivo, ele vem tentando fazer uma política de inclusão a partir da participação dos jovens, mas temos os deparados, é dois, tá, galera? São dois. Nós trabalhamos em parceria, né, por sermos uma secretaria de defesa social com Polícia Civil, Polícia Militar, também com o Ministério Público, então com tudo isso que o doutor Mário até falou, que eu destaquei um pouco, que é a questão de como fazer mediação em situações onde tem dois brigas de gangues que agem de uma certa forma fora da lei. Né? Então é um problema com a situação que o programa vem tentando trabalhar com isso, né? Assim, na verdade, nós trabalhamos em áreas onde essas questões legais elas estão realmente em suspenso, então geralmente são jovens que já cometeram algum delito ou que têm, às vezes, até um mandado judicial. Então, nós precisamos estar vendo uma perspectiva de fazer uma mediação, mesmo em situações onde os jovens já não estão numa situação legal tão tranquila. Né? E uma pergunta, pode passar, por favor, só passar rapidamente, porque só colocar um pouco as fotos, né? Tem os jovens que a gente vê um pouco da imagem deles, que são núcleos do programa Fica Vivo. Eles também pode passar, por favor. Essa também é uma oficina que nós temos. É um jornal produzido pelos jovens, é um pouco das férias do Cabana. Isso foi um evento que nós tivemos aqui em Belo Horizonte, que foi um grupo de percussão no programa. Deixa eu passar. Isso foram também as intervenções que eles fizeram alguns outdoors da cidade, foram convidados os artistas plásticos e um grupo de grafitagem pôde fazer em alguns outdoors uns desenhos. Isso é uma oficina de teatro, essa é de circo, no Palácio das Artes também essa apresentação. Isso é uma oficina de percussão e malabares, né? De circo. Bem, são algumas oficinas, vamos trazer algumas fotos para a gente conhecer um pouquinho, né, do programa. Na verdade, essas oficinas, como eu disse, são apenas a porta de entrada. Nós temos também outros, vai, oficinas, mas eu gostaria de levantar uma pergunta que se relaciona com o que o Dr. Marco diz a respeito de que as intervenções e o tratamento, elas são geralmente no sentido de corrigir os erros de raciocínio, certo? Que nós então vamos trabalhar a autocorreção e corrigir os erros de raciocínio. E eu vou trazer um caso brevemente, um fragmento de uma situação, posso dizer que é um caso, que nós vivemos bastante recentemente, mas não é um só, infelizmente são vários. Nós trabalhamos com jovens em risco eminente de vida, por isso o programa tem esse nome, inclusive. Né? São jovens que se colocam em risco frequentemente, em risco de morte frequente. Né? É um diagnóstico que nos leva para essas áreas, inclusive, é por causa do grande número de homicídios. E a gente pode perceber claramente que, mesmo quando avisados, ou mesmo quando está claro para eles que eles podem morrer, isso não modifica a forma deles se colocarem frente à morte. Então, nós já vivemos várias situações onde o jovem é avisado, não só pela gangue rival, mas também cotidianamente por outras pessoas, da família, amigos, e às vezes os próprios técnicos, seja do programa, seja de outras, de outros parceiros, e ele próprio sabe sobre isso, e isso não modifica a sua situação frente ao risco de morte. Pelo contrário. Então, a pergunta que me fica é se realmente isso é uma coisa da razão. Né? Se a gente pode pensar, ao contrário do Brasil antes, eu acho que a gente, o problema do que eu vivo, ele realmente traz um trabalho nos fatores gerais, né, mais globais, ele procura trabalhar com esses fatores de risco, seja saúde, seja educação, seja inclusão produtiva, mas também procura levar em conta isso que o senhor trouxe de uma certa forma, uma singularidade, né, de cada sujeito. Mesmo assim, eu acho que tem uma pergunta que nos inquieta, que é se nós podemos afirmar que transformar isso em conhecimento vai mudar a posição do sujeito
frente ao seu risco de morte. Obrigado. Convidamos a doutora Roselina Costa Oliveira, da Secretaria Municipal de Saúde de Belo Horizonte, para a sua apresentação.
Bom dia a todos e a todas. Bom dia ao professor Marques. Eu gostaria de fazer minha fala em duas direções. Uma, no sentido de responder um pouco o que ele perguntou, da nossa experiência aqui, e outra, no sentido de problematizar e de perguntar para ele também sobre as pesquisas, né, e a sua fala. Primeiro, quando eu recebi o convite, que eu vi o tema, né, a racionalidade da violência, a primeira coisa que me ocorreu foi perguntar, a violência tem uma racionalidade? Né? E durante a sua fala aqui, eu fiquei me perguntando se a violência não tem diferentes racionalidades, né? Os diferentes tipos de violência com diferentes racionalidades, essa racionalidade muito colocada aqui a partir de quem pratica o ato de violência, né? Porque para quem é vítima do ato de violência, para a sociedade como um todo, nos parece, né, quando a gente pensa na violência, a gente pensa exatamente ao contrário, pensa em alguém que perdeu a racionalidade e por isso praticou um ato de violência. Então, eu acho que o próprio tema ele já é instigante nesse sentido. Bom, nós temos na Secretaria Municipal de Saúde um grupo de trabalho que se denomina Comissão de Abordagem à Violência, onde nós trabalhamos aí os diferentes tipos de violência, né? A violência sexual, a violência doméstica, da qual as maiores vítimas são mulheres, crianças e agora também a gente tem visto que os idosos, né, são vítimas de violência na nossa sociedade. A violência urbana, que essa nós não temos como setor de saúde especificamente, como a Marta falou, uma atuação, né? O setor de saúde sozinho não tem como atuar na violência urbana, mas as nossas unidades de saúde, as unidades de urgência, né? Grande parte da sua demanda é atender a vítima de violência urbana, e os centros de saúde, as unidades de atenção básica, muitas delas em Belo Horizonte estão localizadas no meio do tráfico de drogas, onde há disputa entre gangues, e as unidades, os profissionais de saúde acabam sofrendo a consequência dessa disputa, ou diretamente, porque às vezes vai alguém ferido para dentro da unidade de saúde, né? E a gangue, como contrário, entra na unidade querendo resgatar essa pessoa para eliminá-la, né? Ou vai mesmo procurando assistência médica, né? Então, de diversas formas, as unidades de saúde estão envolvidas aí com a questão da violência. E um outro tipo de violência que nós estamos trabalhando, que nós chamamos de violência institucional, que é a violência entre usuários dos serviços de saúde e trabalhadores dos serviços de saúde, que podem ser desde violências mais leves, né, são agressões verbais, como também agressões físicas, né, tem acontecido em alguns momentos agressões físicas de usuários que chegam no centro de saúde querendo ser atendidos imediatamente e que não, às vezes não está disponível aquele atendimento que ele foi procurar, né, e ele parte para uma agressão ao trabalhador da saúde. Claro que tudo isso é trabalhado aí com os órgãos de segurança pública, né, tanto a polícia militar, nos casos extremos, quanto a guarda municipal. Mas também trabalha no sentido de melhorar as relações. E aí eu queria falar um pouquinho dessa questão da prevenção da violência, né? Quando o professor fala que entre as mulheres, né, há uma possibilidade de ocorrência menor de violência, porque a mulher permite a entrada ou chama, ou permite a entrada de um terceiro, a gente tem trabalhado também, como foi falado aqui pela colega que falou do Fica Vivo, a ideia da mediação de conflitos, né? De você ter uma terceira pessoa que entre nesse espaço de disputa, né? E que consiga desfazer aquele momento que é o momento de acirramento das relações, né? Então, isso ainda é um aprendizado, estamos desenvolvendo essa possibilidade da mediação de conflito, e eu gostaria até de saber se na sua experiência há algum trabalho nesse sentido. Bom, do ponto de vista da violência sexual e o envolvimento aí, né, dos profissionais de saúde, nós podemos dizer que os pediatras, os profissionais que atendem crianças, já há uma história de envolvimento com a questão da violência, né, onde há notificação para o Conselho Tutelar, e há, inclusive, resoluções e normas que exigem essa notificação, né? Em relação à violência contra a mulher, essa situação já é uma situação mais delicada, e aí nós vivemos uma questão em relação à justiça, né, que é a consequência para o profissional de saúde dele denunciar um ato de violência cometido contra a mulher, principalmente porque quando ele está no centro de saúde, e nós trabalhamos em Belo Horizonte com as equipes de saúde da família, né? Então os profissionais estão ali muito perto da residência, portanto ele está próximo da vítima e próximo do agressor, né? E o risco que é para ele essa denúncia, né? Risco mesmo de a sua integridade física, a possibilidade de sofrer, né, uma violência em consequência dessa denúncia. E aí é o que nós estamos trabalhando junto com o Ministério da Saúde, tentando separar notificação para efeito de saúde pública, porque nós precisamos conhecer o fenômeno da violência, saber quantas e contra quem está sendo cometido, né? Então, isso que a gente chama de notificar, quer dizer, notificar não no sentido de denunciar para a justiça, mas de os órgãos de saúde pública, a Secretaria Municipal, a Secretaria Estadual de Saúde e o Ministério da Saúde, tenham informações, né, sobre o fenômeno da violência. E a questão da denúncia, que no caso de um adulto, né, a própria vítima, ela tem essa autodeterminação de denunciar ou não, diferente de uma criança, né? A criança, o profissional de saúde, ele tem que fazer essa denúncia e fazer ao conselho tutelar. Mas o adulto, que está em suas perfeitas faculdades de autodecisão, de autodeterminação, cabe a ele ser orientado, ou a ela, a mulher, né, para fazer essa denúncia. Nós estamos nesse momento nos preparando para fazer uma capacitação dos profissionais de saúde da rede municipal de saúde, no sentido tanto de trabalhar a prevenção da violência, a notificação e também o atendimento às vítimas de violência, ainda com dificuldade de equacionar melhor essa relação, né, da abordagem, do atendimento à saúde, que é a nossa missão, com as consequências do ponto de vista da justiça e o envolvimento do profissional nesse processo. Obrigada.
Encerrando esse bloco de questionamentos, convidamos a doutora Raquel Bacarini, da Secretaria de Estado da Saúde.
Bom dia, pessoal. Primeiro, quero agradecer a doutora Elza pelo convite, a oportunidade de estar aqui. Estou muito feliz de perceber que várias partes da sociedade de questão da violência. Essa semana, o Brasil, infelizmente, teve na mídia mundial contra a violência em São Paulo. Ontem foi o Dia Internacional de Luta contra a Violência Sexual, o abuso sexual de jovens, crianças e adolescentes. Hoje, está havendo um evento da Secretaria de Saúde para a implantação do protocolo estadual de violência sexual. Então, eu queria mostrar para vocês o nosso trabalho. A violência sexual na Secretaria de Estado está a cargo da Coordenadoria Sexual do SBI, sou coordenadora, e nós estamos implantando um protocolo do Estado, no sentido de acolher essa vítima, essa mulher, no primeiro momento, tá? Com atendimento médico, equipe de médico, psicólogo e assistente social, no segundo momento, um acompanhamento de serviço de referência, e também a questão da notificação, da denúncia. O nosso trabalho tem sido muito na questão da necessidade de denunciar, quebra o silêncio, denuncie, e as notificações, porque é só através disso que vai se poder fazer uma política pública em relação a isso. Então, nós estamos capacitando municípios e implantando esse protocolo no órgão do município de municípios do Estado de Minas. Atualmente, agora, são 8 implantados e mais 5 até o final desse ano. Então, eu vou trazer para vocês aqui alguns números da violência sexual no Estado. Enquanto ela está colocando ali, vou falando, a gente tem tempo. Em 2004, foram notificados à Coordenadoria do Estado 307 casos de violência sexual. Em 2005, foram 394. Tá? Em 2003, foram menos, 243. Então, está havendo um aumento da notificação. No aumento dos casos, mas muito em função do aumento da educação, do aumento da conscientização da população, que é isso que a gente está esperando, tá? Desse percentual de 2005, 8% tem menos de 10 anos de idade, 39% tem de 10 a 19 anos, 32% tem de 20 a 29 anos, tá? E 13% nas faixas maiores, acima dos 30 anos. Então, vocês veem que a maior faixa é dos 10 a 19, e um grande percentual também nas crianças. A a violência sexual, ela tem uma face muito triste, porque o maior percentual dela, o grande percentual acontece dentro de casa, é a violência doméstica, a violência causada geralmente por padrasto, por tio, por pai. E o nosso trabalho tem sido muito em função de dar visibilidade a essa questão da violência de dentro de casa, fora a violência externa que aparece na mídia frequentemente. Bom, nós trabalhamos com a equipe, esse trabalho só é possível ser feito junto com várias instituições, com a Secretaria de Defesa, com a Secretaria de Desenvolvimento e Esportes, Polícia Civil, Polícia Militar, Conselho de Tutelares de Criança, Conselho da Mulher. E nós esperamos estar com esse protocolo contribuindo para diminuir a violência e aumentando a notificação, aumentando o número de denúncias para que a gente possa exercer as políticas públicas.
Obrigada. Eu gostaria de convidar o Dr. Marcos Tapa a retornar aqui à mesa. Poor people, of course, are not guaranteed that. We may not have a faucet to turn on in the morning.
They face many uncertainties that the vast majority of us do not face. They have trouble controlling the things that happen to them in a very general sense. Well, how is this related to violence? To the extent that the people, poor people, for example, have trouble controlling events and things around them, they will tend to develop what I would call a low perceived capacity for control. They'll come to accept the fact that they really can't control the things that are happening to them in their own lives. For violence, one of the manifestations, and I'm trying to be brief so I don't mention others, but one of the manifestations is that people who have this low perceived capacity for control will not tend to solicit the intervention of others for peaceful resolution of disputes. In some instances, they simply do not have available to them these third parties to whom they can turn. For example, in many poor parts of cities in Brazil and the United States, the police are unavailable. So even if it is a dispute that can be handled by legal officials, the legal officials are absent. Or if they're there, poor people don't believe that the police will do anything in response to their requests. Again, pointing to the importance of perceived capacity for control. There are structural conditions, like I mentioned, that make it possible for some persons, victims in particular, to solicit the intervention of third parties. And I was thinking about the situation of women. I was mentioning this to someone yesterday. I recently read some research about differences in victimization of women in different kinds of societies. Put briefly, there's much more victimization of women in those societies where upon marriage, the woman goes to live with the family of the husband. This is in contrast to a situation where upon marriage, women go to live with their own family. Now, in terms of what I described, this makes perfect sense. In a situation where the woman is cut off from her own family members, she has fewer people who are sympathetic with her complaints, with her problems. And in that kind of situation, violence is likely to be much more frequent. So this is a structural situation that can help us to understand high rates of victimization of women. There are many other such examples, structural examples, that I can give. There was an Italian criminologist who over 100 years ago was imploring the Catholic Church to liberalize its divorce laws. And the criminologist who was doing this was pointing to the fact that there were extremely high rates of familial spousal homicides. Well, in terms of what I described, in marital situations where there are frequent disputes, but what you want is a situation where people can somehow resolve those disputes peacefully. Well, one of the ways that marital disputes sometimes resolve disputes is through divorce. If this option is completely unavailable to them and they try all other options up to that point, then the only available option may ultimately be homicide or violence. Again, that may seem very irrational to us, but maybe understandable from the part of the disputes. One of the things I've seen in the United States in terms of my own research, and this is sort of an interesting fact about violence, there's a very high ratio of homicide involving separated persons to divorced persons. So if we take the number of homicides involving separated persons divided by the number of homicides involving married persons, there's a much greater number of homicides involving separated persons. Why? Perhaps because in these kinds of situations, they're not turning to legal officials, in this case, the courts, to solicit divorce in order to resolve marital disputes. Now, of course, this is an option that you normally would not want to encourage marital disputes to seek divorce. But for some, this may be the only non-violent alternative to seek. This sort of legal means of settling disputes is important because, again, getting back to the example of the poor don't have access to the same means of resolution for disputes by legal authorities that more affluent people might have. But when two affluent people get into a dispute about property, you may hire their own attorneys, their own lawyers, to go to court to resolve this dispute. But poor people, of course, don't have the capacity to do that. So there are all kinds of structural interpretations or correlations that I would describe very much in your personal level. So I very much appreciate that comment, and I very much appreciate the importance of it. But what I heard with regard to the description of the peak of evil was very much consistent with what I described in terms of the importance of dispute resolution, mediation, and so forth. And I'll link that to something that was said later about the importance of responding to the needs of victims. One of the things I believe is very important with regard to the victims is somehow empowering them, getting them to believe that they can actually do something about the situation in which they find themselves. And researchers have reported for a very long time. But one of the problems with spousal abuse, spousal violence in particular, is getting the victims to report their victimization experiences, to go to legal officials or family members or neighbors or whoever, because they often feel that they don't have the power to report this to other people. They may fear retaliation, and this may be a very real concern that they might have. But this has been very much a problem in the U.S. and has been in other societies, empowering victims, somehow providing them with a feeling that they really can, or the belief that they really can do something about their experience, increasing their perceived capacity for control again. This is a very difficult thing to do for many women, and perhaps even poor women, as compared to the more affluent women. I think it's very much consistent by the stride in terms of the importance of the belief that one can affect the events and things around them, including our own victimization experiences. One of the questions that was asked at the very end was whether or not this empowerment of victims might result in an increase in reporting. And that is a real, very, very possibility. It's a kind of paradox. And to the extent that you can empower victims of family violence in particular to report their experiences, to try to get some relief from the victimization experiences, as it becomes known that victims have this power to do this kind of thing, there will undoubtedly be an increase in the reports of these kinds of offenses. To those who believe that the policies always ought to decrease the reported number of offenses, this is something that will trouble them, because there ought to be an increase in these kinds of reports of victimization. We've seen in the United States, for example, over the past 20 years or so, a very large increase in the number of reported rapes. The United States, and the same for Brazil, there are several ways of gathering information about rape. One is from police reports. So here, victims are reporting their rape victimizations to legal authorities. Another way, though, and a way for certain police, a much better, more accurate way of gathering information about rape, is in what we call victimization surveys. These are surveys of people in communities, this kind of victimization research is already launched in Rio and other Brazilian cities. And here, people are asked to report to interviewers about their victimization experiences during the previous 6 months or the previous year or whatever. In the U.S., we get different kinds of information about rape from police reports and victimization surveys. If we look at rape rates, according to police records, there's been an enormous increase in rape over the past 30 or 40 years or so. If we look at victimization surveys, there's been no increase. There's been no decrease either, but it's been a relatively flat line. But what researchers tend to believe is an account for this discrepancy is that over time, female victims of rape have been much more willing to report their victimization experiences to the police than they were previously. In other words, what the police see with regard to rape is a higher percentage of the number of rapes that have been occurring all along. this is important to note, because in the United States, 40 years ago, rape victims were often re-victimized by the criminal justice system. They were often questioned quite intensively about perhaps whether a rape occurred in the first place. Legal officials tended to initially doubt victims' reports of their rape experiences. To the extent that, legal officials believed that, yes, there was some kind of, inappropriate behavior here, they began to then question the victim about how she might have enticed the offender to violate her. Well, many victims' groups and women's groups generally began to complain quite loudly, quite publicly about this kind of treatment of rape victims. Slowly, law enforcement officials began to change the way they responded to rape victims. One of the most important changes was to bring female law enforcement officials into the process so that they could interview rape victims, and they were seen as less threatening to the victims. Well, this became known in a very general sense, and women in the U.S. now are much more likely to report their rape victimizations to the police than they ever were before. There's been an increase in the reported number of rapes. But in this sense, that increase seems to be very good. It's something that we should welcome. And we should continue to welcome even larger increases, perhaps, in the rate of reported rape. So in this sense, yes, I think empowering victims, empowering rape victims, victims of sexual abuse, physical abuse, whatever kind of violence victimization we're talking about, to the extent that we can empower victims or potential victims, there will be an increase in the amount of that kind of crime done to legal officials. But that's something we should welcome rather than avoid.
E, além disso, né, eu tenho uma relação um pouco mais duradoura com o professor Machado, porque eu fui orientando dele. Né? Então, justamente, a minha pesquisa de tese foi sobre a resolução de conflitos de uma favela no Rio de Janeiro. Mas uma das coisas que eu queria destacar é que as pesquisas que o Cristo desenvolve sempre têm uma perspectiva de aplicabilidade. Como que nós podemos, com as nossas pesquisas, criar programas de prevenção ou programas de intervenção para modificar a situação? Então, eu queria retomar um pouco, pensando em algumas das coisas que o Cristo tem dito ultimamente. Eu não vou falar de ficativo, porque eu acho que a Ludmilla tem uma apresentação muito bela de ficativo, porém, seus alguns programas mais destacantes que o Cristo se desenvolve na área de prevenção. Mas tem uma série de pesquisas baseadas em entender um pouco o perfil do crime, especificamente no município de Belo Horizonte, mas também no estado de Minas Gerais, sempre com o intuito de entrar em ação, né? De ver a que ponto que essa informação pode gerar políticas públicas. Uma das grandes exemplos do Cristo tem sido isso. Então, por exemplo, o professor Marcos Chaves agora mencionou um curso de vitimização, né? Tentando entender, por exemplo, na população geral, independente, né? Das informações que nós temos das polícias, qual é a taxa de criminalidade na população, quantas pessoas de fato são vítimas, independente de irem à polícia ou não. Também, temos desenvolvido uma série de pesquisas para entender a situação de violência nas escolas, que nas suas fases mais recentes também tenta entender qual é a prevalência da delinquência juvenil, perguntamos aos próprios jovens na escola, além da sua vitimização, além das incidências de violência na escola, quais dessas incidências eles mesmos cometeram. Concluindo, qual o intuito? Qual é a racionalidade, desculpa a palavra, desse tipo de pesquisa? A ideia de tentar pensar em intervenções. Então, uma das coisas que o CRISP destaca é a questão da oportunidade. Até que ponto que existem oportunidades para a conexão desses eventos? Uma grande parte da vitimização, do senhor de vitimização, pergunta detalhadamente sobre o que aconteceu, aonde foi o evento, a que hora do dia, em qual local, qual é o dano, se a pessoa tentou resistir, quantas pessoas, né, no caso do roubo, quantos ofensores, óbvio, se eram homens, mulheres, sexo, se eram conhecidos ou não, de tentar uma série de informações sobre o evento em si. A mesma coisa acontece com todo o trabalho que o Cristo tem feito na organização dos profissionais da polícia. Então, o Cristo se destaca na área de georreferenciamento, de tentar saber exatamente aonde estão acontecendo esses eventos na cidade. Tanto o centro de vitimização, a pesquisa de vitimização, quanto essa ideia de georreferenciar os dados da polícia, tem a ideia de entender aonde que as coisas estão acontecendo e o que, que pode ser feito para diminuir as oportunidades. Então, a colocação que eu tenho do professor Marques seria tentar integrar essa nova ideia da racionalidade com uma ênfase sobre a oportunidade. Ele mencionou, por exemplo, com a teoria do autocontrole, é dado de que existe uma impossibilidade, que as pessoas com pouco autocontrole precisem simplesmente de uma oportunidade. Então, uma das possibilidades de ação do Estado seria talvez diminuir ao máximo possível as oportunidades. Nós fazemos isso no nosso dia a dia. Andamos no centro com as janelas fechadas do carro, né, as portas trancadas, não andamos com muito dinheiro, instalamos cerca elétrica, luz durante as nossas casas, alarmes, etc. Nós já colocamos essa ideia de diminuição das oportunidades no nosso dia a dia. Né? A ideia de maior faturamento das crises em áreas onde está acontecendo certos eventos criminais também tem instituído essa ideia. Então, eu fico pensando aonde que nós podemos conciliar essa nova definição da racionalidade, tentar trabalhar e entender essa racionalidade para que nós temos dessa perspectiva, entendemos quais são considerados os custos, né, na perspectiva dessa nova racionalidade, que talvez, para o nosso olhar objetivo, não pareça tão racional, porém pode ter uma racionalidade, onde que nós podemos atuar para diminuir essas oportunidades e aumentar esse custo. Né? Porque talvez na eliminação das oportunidades seja uma forma que nós podemos implantar essas políticas. Então, a minha colocação é essa. Obrigada.
Convidamos a professora Maria Beatriz Rios Filho, do Núcleo de Estudos de Violência da PUC-Minas. Então, convidamos o doutor Lucas Freire, do Núcleo de Atenção a Riscos e Crimes Violentos.
Esse núcleo é uma parceria do Programa Nacional de Direitos Humanos, com o Estado, através da Secretaria Social de Desenvolvimento e Esportes. O núcleo oferece às vítimas quatro tipos de crimes violentos. São o homicídio, o latrocínio, o estupro e o atentado grande volume. Oferece atendimento psicológico, jurídico e serviço social, para buscar integrar, ouvir e discutir com essa vítima esse episódio que ela sofreu. Muitas vezes a gente está na palestra, a gente percebeu que a necessidade de se discutir a prevenção do crime não é o caso dos crimes sexuais. Muitas vezes a pessoa busca um atendimento psicológico, mas ela não quer que uma denúncia, ela não quer levar aquela situação no estado para evitar realmente essa vitimização. Então é esclarecido para ela o procedimento criminal, como que ela deve se proceder na delegacia e informar, principalmente, ela tem o direito a não levar aqui em diante. Então, isso às vezes pode esclarecer para os profissionais de saúde, para as outras áreas do conhecimento, meio chocante. Eles têm o direito da pessoa de também não levar, não querer intervenção estatal na apuração desses crimes. E só dar um toque, o que eu percebi, a minha experiência no grupo de atendimento às vítimas, é que a grande maioria só tem conhecimento dos seus direitos, dos direitos fundamentais, dos direitos humanos, quando fala de direitos humanos, fala de educação, direito à moradia, direito a uma saúde digna, né? Ela só tem conhecimento desses direitos quando ela sofre uma violação, quando ela é vítima de um crime. Deveria ser um contrato. Ela deveria ter acesso a uma política pública de educação, uma política pública de inclusão social, uma política pública de mercado de trabalho. Né? Antes de ser uma vítima, antes de se tornar uma vítima. Então, nesses eventos agora que aconteceu em São Paulo, é natural para a sociedade perguntar, vamos aumentar as penas, vamos endurecer a legislação penal, como se isso fosse uma resposta. Isso, pela experiência, não vai resolver o problema. Agora a gente tem que se questionar o seguinte, essas políticas públicas estão funcionando, as políticas...